Good morning and happy Sabbath, church family. So good to see so many faces here. Admittedly, it's a little colder outside than it has been the past few days, but I am thankful that it is warm in here, and especially warm with the Spirit. Thank you for joining us today, and I want to thank those for joining online as well. Pastor Dave has a couple announcements, but before I invite him up, I would just like to point out, in our bulletin, there's this little fold-out, tear-out piece. You can think of this as your way to keep in touch with us, so that you know what is going on around here at Central, and you can just drop that in the offering plate when it comes by. Pastor Dave, you have a couple announcements for us.
Thank you, Mason. As you've noticed that we've had set up some tables in the back for life groups, and we want to say thank you for signing up for those because they will change your life. We also want to just let you know that we're working on the demographics. We're working on connecting leaders with homes that have opened up for host homes and then those who are helping with refreshments. But be sure and sign up if you haven't yet, and we're going to be letting you know that we're hoping to help you find a group that you'll just love to be in for who knows how long, but just being connected with that. And we're trying to set them up demographically so that you can do that. Also, I wanted to mention too, on the 17th, that's a Wednesday at 7:15, I think it's called Tinseltown. It's at a movie. We're going to a movie. And that is The Hopeful. A friend of mine, Kevin Christensen, helped design this movie. It's about our Adventist heritage. In 900 different theaters here in America, this movie will be shown. And so we're working together with South Church. And if you want a ticket, be sure and sign up. You can do it online, or you can sign up here. We're also, our Wednesday evening group is all going to go. So you don't want to miss this movie. It's 7:15 on Wednesday, the 17th, and there'll be more information. And you can look online, you can look on e-news, but we'll give you that information. And we'd like to go together. Now, you do have to make an RSVP because we have to get tickets. So be sure and RSVP, our Secretary Gail, if you'd like to go. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor Dave, for that, those announcements, and the reminder for the life groups. I know for the young adult life group in particular, it's made a big difference to me, and I'm really glad that we are coming together to fellowship and interact even just outside of the sanctuary and just really grow closer together and closer to God. And with that, would please join me as we worship our God in praise.
Good morning, happy Sabbath. Please stand and sing with us as we praise our Lord and Savior. Chains are
Congregation, please kneel with me as we approach the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, here we are to worship. We're not here to do anything else. We are here for you. I want to thank you, Lord, for this church family, this congregation. I want to thank you for the many things that you do for us that we may miss or not recognize. Lord, we come to you as well with requests on our hearts, and I thank you that you already know what they are before we even think about them or ask them. And I praise you again for all the goodness that you bring to us in our lives. In your name, amen. Today's offering is for the local church budget, and when I think about this offering, one of the reasons that I am thankful for this offering in particular, besides, of course, just keeping this sanctuary lit and warm, is the community of believers that the church budget makes possible. Many people in this church have supported both my wife and I through times of storms and trouble. And without this church and without the church budget offering, we would not likely have received this kind of fellowship or encouragement that comes from this congregation of believers. And for that, I am thankful for both this church and this offering. Would the deacons please rise? Dear Heavenly Father, we have an opportunity here to give back to you. When we really think about it, there's very little that we can, if anything, that we can claim ownership for ourselves. It all comes from you. So thank you for this opportunity that we have to give back to you for the many things that you give for us. Please bless this offering and help it to do great things both inside this church and outside this church. In your name, amen.
Thank you. and happy Sabbath. My name is Bethann Clark, for who may not have known yet. And you might be wondering why I'm standing up here this morning. I'm here representing the Sabbath School Division this morning. We will be recognizing their accomplishment in their classes. They will be promoted from one class to another today. And I just want to say thank you to our volunteers, and thank you to the parents for sending your children or taking your children to Sabbath school in the mornings. Because not only do they learn Bible stories, their faith gets strengthened. They make new friends. And as we nurture and admonition them in the name of the Lord, we ask that you will continue to send them out, continue to teach them the values of Christ. And as they grow from strength to strength, we pray that God will continue to cover them. Now we invite the children from the beginners, teacher and students from the beginners class. So first we have little Gabriela Powell Casaneras. Evan Ivy. Christian Watts. Is Jonathan Cowley here? Okay, so we just want to say thank you to the beginners. And God bless you. Now we have kindergarten. Okay, so this is our kindergarten group. They'll be moving up to primary. And we have Harper Ton, JJ Anderson, Ethan Strong, Elizabeth Babineau, Hannah Anderson, Finley Mann.
And as you see, most of ours obviously already thought they were graduated because they're not here.
So this is the kindergarten who will be moving to primary. I just want to say thank you all. Now we have our primary, who will be moving on to junior. So we have Genesis Powell. G. Giovanna Powell. Aliana D'Souza. Okay, so that's it for the primaries. We'll be moving on to junior. We just want to say thank you to parents, teachers, and students. And now for the juniors who will be moving on to early teen. We have Jacob Halston. Hope I got it correctly. Thank you so very much. And as we come to the end of the promotion, I just want to encourage you to continue to send your children out to Sabbath school. And I will leave it with you St. Matthew 19, verse 14, where Jesus said to suffer the little children to come unto him and don't hinder them, for unto such belongs the kingdom of heaven. Thank you, and I invite Pastor Dave at this moment.
Yes, we would like all of the teachers in our younger divisions to stand up with all of their helpers. Would you just stand up? Don't be embarrassed. We won't embarrass you too much. All of the teachers, all of the helpers, take a look at all of these who sacrificed their time. Thank you so much. We appreciate all that you do. We just want you to know that. And also, too, to remember that some of these young people, this is the beginning stages of their spiritual journey, and they'll never forget what you do in those classrooms. So thank you so much.
Well, it's time for all the children to come forward, and as they come forward, if you've got any money, go ahead and give it to them. We'll put it in the sanctuary. That's for Springs Adventist Academy. Normally we have Springs Adventist Academy here, but they're up at an event up in Campion, so I'm filling in this Sabbath. I also want to highlight the movie The Hopeful. You heard Pastor Dave talk about that. When you think about that and you think about going, this is an opportunity for outreach. I'll tell you an example for myself and Svetlana. We have invited a former Jehovah's Witness and a wild and crazy Pentecostal guy to come with us to this movie. So we see it as an outreach to people to understand the beginnings of our Adventist faith. And if you see the trailer, it's very well done. It's a very dramatic beginning of our Adventist faith. So I encourage all of you to put somebody or somebodies that you could reach out to bring to this film. They could become familiar with our Adventist faith. Good. Are they coming? Good. They're still... Got somebody back there really pulling out of people. That's good. All right, we're getting close. Once everybody's up here, yep, go ahead and stick her in there. There you go, good. Go stick her right in there. Very good. Okay, everybody, what do I got here? A box. What's in it? Very good. You can be trained. All right. So what do you think what rock we're going to have today? Any guesses? Can one of you guys help me out? Can you hold this for me so I can open it? Can you hold that? Great. Thank you so much. All right. So let's see what we got here. Ooh, look at this. Cool. Great. Thank you. So, okay. So this is a box of rocks. So the question I always ask is, are you smarter than a box of rocks? Or are you dumber than a box of rocks? Who's smarter than a box of rocks? Okay, who's dumber than a box of rocks? No. Thank you. I'm sure you're smarter than a box of rocks, young lady. I'm sure of that. Now, I won't ask the adults because they'll get embarrassed, right? Because why is that? Because rocks do what God created them to do, right? If you take a rock and you throw it up in the air, what's it do? It falls right back down, right? Because it follows God's laws. So when you follow God's laws, you're smarter than a box of rocks. And if you don't, then you're dumber than a box of rocks. So let's see what we got here today. Yeah, what's this look like here? Any guesses? Yeah, it's a rock. Is it pretty? It's a pebble. Yeah, is it pretty? Okay. This is called a ruby or carnelian, depending on how you want to call it. So it's kind of reddish in color. And so in the Bible, we see that on the priestly breastplate representing one of the children of Israel. And the book of Revelation, you're going to see this in heaven. Where are you going to see it in heaven? It's going to be on the wall that surrounds the city. Right? It says in Revelation, this rock. And so this rock has a lot of significance because I'm going to bring this up from the Proverbs. I have to bring up my little notes here. So remember we've been talking about wisdom, right? How many of you are smart? How many think you're smart? That's good. I'm glad to see that. Right? Because we say wisdom. Proverbs 8, 10, 11 says, choose my instruction instead of silver, knowledge rather than choice gold, for wisdom is more precious than rubies. Right? So how much do you think a really expensive ruby is worth? Yep, yeah, over $1,000, right? You get a really nice polished ruby, you can get some of those for $1,000, maybe $10,000. So the second verse I'm going to bring up, which is really interesting, is in Proverbs 31. It says, a wife of noble character, who can find? She is worth more than rubies. Her children arise and call her blessed. So how many think your mom is worth more than $10,000? Very good. Yeah, all your hands should be up, right? Yeah, all of our mothers should be worth over. So we're going to practice something because it says arise and call her blessed, all right? So we're going to practice a couple times. So when you see your mom, okay, everybody rise up. Everybody stand up. What do you call your mother? How many call her mom? How many call her mama? How many call your mom? How many call your mom? How many call her mama? Okay, we're split. All right, so we'll practice one with mom. All right, so now say, mom, be blessed. Let's try that again. Mom, be blessed. Mom, be blessed. Okay, sit down. Let's try it one more time. Practice, okay? So next time you see your mom, okay, everybody stand up. You're going to rise, stand up. You're going to look at your mom, and you're going to say, mama, be blessed. Mama, be blessed. Very good. You're trained. I can count on you. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for our moms. We thank you that this is, they're more precious than rubies, and we know that they're here, that they love us, and we pray that we would arise and bless them. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, church. The scripture today is in keeping with the theme. How would it feel like for you? How would you use your clout if you were adopted by the king's daughter? If you grew up in his courts? However, there's a caveat. How about if you grew up in his courts, but you were raised by your mother? That's what happened to Moses. And his mother, like the teachers that you saw here with our children this morning, and his mother taught Moses the ways of the Lord, the ways of the Bible, the way that he should go when he was old and he would not depart from it. So if you stand with me, we're going to read the scripture this morning. Would you stand? And I want to you pay special attention to this because it would be so easy for Moses to say, oh, you know who I am? I was raised in the king's court. I've got special privilege here. But pay attention to the scripture this morning. It says this, by faith Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a short time. Amen? We should take a lesson from Moses. Be seated, please.
God and God alone created all these things we call our own. From the mighty to the small, the glory in them all is God's and God's alone. God and God alone will be the joy of our eternal hope. Let everything that lives reserve its truest praise for God and God alone. God and God alone. God and God alone is fit to take the universe's throne. He will be our one desire. Our hearts will never tire of God and God alone. God and God alone is fit to take the universe's throne. And all the best and worst of men can change the master's plan. It's God's and God's alone. Let everything that lives reserve its truest praise for God and God alone. Let everything that lives reserve its truest praise.
Thank you, Marilyn. You know, Marilyn was just baptized last Sabbath, and here she is bringing in a message of hope, and it's all about God and God alone, amen? Thank you for that beautiful, beautiful song, Marilyn. I want to begin with two verses of Scripture as we begin, and they're right here on the screen. It's we're starting a brand new series. It's called Because He Lives. And it's in Philippians 4 and verses 6 and 7. I have it right up here on the screen. It says, don't worry about anything. I just pause there for a moment. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for what He has done, what He's already done. Then verse 7, it says, then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as we live in Christ Jesus. It's all about living in Him. Amen. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your word. I pray it'll speak life to us today. Again, I ask you to make me a simple nail on a wall. Hang a beautiful, shining picture of your son's face in its place. I ask in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. I love the story of Jesus. You know, following Jesus was never meant to be confined to an hour on Sabbath. But this story, I have had people tell me it's the story of Jesus. Unbelievable. I say, well, it's just so unbelievably believable. No one could make up a story like this. You couldn't make up a story like this. Lee Strobel, he tells a story on himself, how his wife decided to go to church with another lady, and she kept going, and she came back, and he says, well, I'm going to disprove that this whole Christianity thing, that Christ was a myth. Now, secular historians agree that Jesus Christ truly was a historical figure. The problem they have is this resurrection thing. And so this is what Lee Strobel decided to disprove. And so he sets out for a few months, and he's the chief editor in the Chicago Tribune. He's a lawyer, and he's a legal editor for the Chicago Tribune. So he knew it wouldn't take him long to disprove this theory of Jesus Christ. And then he says this, I was going to prove to my wife, I'm reading here, I'm going to prove to my wife that this story was a hoax, a myth, just some big misunderstanding. I came to the conclusion that it would require so much more faith to remain an atheist than to become a Christian. And this is what he says right here. I met Lee Strobel. He wrote a book. He wrote a book called The Case for Christ. But listen to this. He says, based on the evidence I abandoned atheism and embraced Jesus as my forgiver, my leader, and my friend. And there's from a man who set out to disprove this whole theory, this belief that Jesus Christ was who he said he was. Now, more has been written about this one solitary life than any other historical figure in all of ancient or modern literature. In fact, there's an estimated 146 million books written about this one life, Jesus Christ. Did you hear that? 146 million books. And in this story, his story, if we could call it history, his story, this groundbreaking, earth-shaking, heart-stopping story of the sovereignty of God. Now, if you don't know the sovereignty of God now, you will the second after you die. Because in 1 Corinthians 15, it says, in a moment, the blinking of an eye, we shall be changed, and we'll see the one. In Revelation chapter 1 and verse 7, it says, every eye will see him. Every eye. You see, in death and burial and resurrection, Jesus gave the answer to every question that we have. He really did. And the only thing that we can do is to live in the joy of what he's already accomplished and done for us. John Piper says it this way, God is most glorified when we're most satisfied in him. James Allen Francis reminds us that Jesus was born in an obscure village to a peasant woman, and he lived in another town, but he grew up in a carpenter shop for 30 years. For 3.5 years, he was an itinerant preacher. In fact, he never wrote a book. He never held an office. He never went to college. He never owned a home. He never lived in a big city. He never had a family. He never did all of those things that we would acquire for greatness. In fact, after 3 years of 33 years of his life, his friends, the tide of popular opinion turned against him, and his friends abandoned him. One betrayed him, one denied him, but they all forsook him. And then those who accused him put him on a cross. And the only thing that he owned, his executioners gambled for his garments. And then we see him being laid in a borrowed grave. I can see Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea, very wealthy men, very the higher upper echelon of the society back then, and they go to Pilate and they request the body of Jesus, and they go to Pilate and say, we'd like to take Jesus' body. We'd like to lay it in the grave. Your grave? Why are you giving your grave, Pilate says. Well, you know what they should have said? Well, he's only going to borrow for a weekend. I mean, it's just, that's all. 20 centuries have passed and gone. Today, he's still the central figure of history to this day. And I'm well within the mark of saying that all of the navies that have ever sailed, all the armies that have ever marched, all the parliaments that have ever sat, all of the kings who have ever ruled, all of the presidents who have ever reigned, this one single solitary life marks humanity like no other life on this planet and has affected more lives than this one single solitary life. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the gospel writers, they meticulously annotate in detail what happened to the life of this man, how he lived, how he was born, and how he died, so that you and I could understand the very facts of what happened. The Apostle Paul. And of course, then you have John. John, the gospel writer John, you have the three synoptics. Then you have John, and in the book of John, I love it when he says, I'm the disciple who Jesus loved. Don't you just love that? He's the only one that said that about himself. But it's in the aorist indicative in the Greek, which doesn't really mean a whole lot to you, but what it actually means is, in the aorist indicative, it says, I'm the disciple Jesus kept on loving. In spite of my faults, in spite of my difficulty, Jesus kept on loving me. Almost sounds like, you know, Jesus loves you, but I'm his favorite. But what John is really saying, in spite of all that I have done, Jesus still keeps on loving me. Now, we're told that non-biblical scholars, they believe that Jesus was a historical figure. And the question is, the real question is, what happened after the cross? That's the question we all have to answer for ourselves. As we stand there at the cross, what really happened after the cross? Because they go to the cross, yes, yes, he died, but that was it. But we have in the book of Acts 500 testimonies, five who believed and they saw this man, the resurrected Jesus Christ. If you want to know why we take this so seriously as pastors and as Christians, is because it's real. It's absolutely real. It's not just some made-up stories. And the reason I believe the Bible is because the gospel writers, 20, 40, 60 years later, they don't make themselves out to be just the heroes. They put Jesus as front and center, and they actually throw themselves under the bus. I mean, look at Peter. There's Peter. He believes, then he doesn't believe, then he says, I never believed, to a teenage junior high girl standing by a fire pit in a courtroom, and then he looks at the eyes of Jesus. It gets me every time. He looks in the eyes of Jesus as that rooster begins to crow. Three times he denies his Savior. And I can just see him as he runs, maybe to the very place in the Garden of Gethsemane where Jesus had just prayed before, and we see him in that moon-bathed patch clutching the cold earth, just wanting to die because he hurt the heart of his best friend. And they throw themselves, they're cowards, deceivers, doubters, deniers. And then they talk about the death of Jesus. What is death? Well, in 3 weeks, I'm going to actually talk about what really happens at death, but death is the most democratic institution on this planet. It allows no discrimination. It tolerates no exceptions. In fact, the mortality rate of mankind is all the same. We all get one death per person. In Psalms 89, it says something very important. Actually, in Psalms 89, it says, the one who can live for, no one can live forever, all will die. All will die. No one can escape the power of the grave. Rich, poor, young and old, good, bad, ugly, beautiful, whatever. We all die. Isn't that a bummer? We just all die. Ecclesiastes 8 and verse 8 says, none of us has the power to prevent the day of our death. There is no escape from it. The genius, the illiterate, the rich, the poor, no one outruns it, no one outdeceives it, no one outlives it, no one outsmarts it. Julius Caesar died, Winston Churchill died, Socrates died, Aristotle died, Princess Diana died, Elvis died. He really did. He died. Telling you the truth. Harry Truman died. Young and old, rich and poor, Democrats, Republicans, Independents, Greens, Christians, non-Christians, atheists, agnostics. We all die. We all die. There's nothing worse than die. Woody Allen says that I'm not afraid to die. I just don't want to be there when it happens. But there are worse things than dying. Have you ever spent an evening with an insurance salesman? I mean, that's pretty bad. But when I die, I want my last words to be, I hit $1 million under the, there you go. But every 2 seconds, every second, two people die. That's 120 minutes, 7,200 every single hour. 172,800 every day. That's 62,678,000 every single year. You all have known someone that has died. We've gone to funerals. I have done more funerals than I've ever wanted to do. I mean, you can drive down the street, you can see a playground and a cemetery on the same block. You can have a baby shower, a wedding, and a funeral on the same calendar, same week. I've done it. You can pop all the pills you want. You can take all the leafy green vegetables and vitamins. You can take blueberries and pomegranates, and you can take aloe vera and melaleuca and leafy, you know, green grass juice and barley green and super smoothies and chia seeds. You can get hyperbolic oxygen therapy. You can get gyrostem therapy, and you can get cryotherapy. Have you ever had cryotherapy, anyone? I have. Buddy of mine wanted minus 300 Fahrenheit for 3 minutes. You get into this chamber. No wonder there's a reason they call it cryotherapy, and they wanted me to come back and pay for it again. I said, no thanks. It's kind of like getting in that plunging, which is pretty good, and it is good for you. But you can stay out of the sun, stay away from alcohol, drugs, and tobacco, and do all of that, do all the things. And you can increase the quality of your life and the quantity of your life. You might live to be 100 as long as you stay away from all the things that make you want to live to be 100. But we all die. It just happens. I know how it is when we pass by the grocery store counter and we see a magazine of this really fit body and say, oh, what I wouldn't do for a body like that, except, you know, eat right and exercise. We can't do that. But there's three things we begin to lose as we get older. Our hearing, our eyesight, and I can't remember the third one. But it gets better. In fact, it gets a whole lot better. Because, see, everyone is telling you, you can just, I mean, everything on the internet is how to increase the quality and the quantity of your life, but only Jesus can tell you how to have eternal life. And that's where I bank my authority on, is that Jesus has eternal life for each and every one of us. Certainly many of us have had health problems. I know that. I hear about it. But maybe I spoke too soon. Wait, maybe I spoke too soon, because maybe God is writing the first chapter in the book of the story of your life. Or maybe he's writing the first paragraph of the first chapter of the story of the book of your life. Or maybe he's writing the first sentence of the paragraph of the chapter of the story of your life. Or maybe he's writing the first word of the first sentence of the first paragraph of the first chapter, or maybe he's even writing the first letter of the first word of the first sentence of the first paragraph of the first chapter of the book of the story of your life. I want to turn to a passage of scripture, but here we are, because when you think about it, when we think about this life that we have, and it shows so very short here on this planet, I love this story in John 11. You'll only find it in John 11. It's the story of Lazarus. Mary and Martha says, hey, the one you love is very sick. We need you to come. Jesus stays 4 days. He tells his disciples, this sickness is not unto death. You can read it. It's in John 11. He says, this sickness is not unto death. He's not going to die. Oh, good. 4 days later, he says, hey, we're going to go wake up Lazarus. Good. Well, he's been sleeping, you know. Not, and then he says, you know what? Actually, he died. He preferred the word sleep. So he goes there, and then he gets to the town of Bethany, and Martha greets him. And says, if only you'd been here sooner. If only you had been here sooner. And she keeps repeating it, because in the Greek, it's in the infinitive, the aorist infinitive. If only you'd been, she kept telling Jesus that. And Jesus says these amazing words, I am the resurrection and the life. In fact, let's look at it here. I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live. Even after dying. Everyone who lives in me and believes in me will what? Will never die. Say it with me. Will never die. Do you believe this? He's not just asking Martha. He's asking us. Do you believe this? Because you see, real Christians never die. They might fall asleep, but they never die. Never die. In 1950s, a doctor at Harvard, his name is Dr. Kurt Richter, he took some rats, and he did this experiment. He had a pool of water, and he put them in the pool of water. He wanted to see how long they could tread water. Anyone guess how long rats can tread water? About 10, 15 minutes before they drown. They pulled them out. They dry them off. They actually comforted these little rats, and then afterwards, he said, let's put them back in. Let's see how long they can do it a second time. Now remember, they're exhausted. They just did it for 15 minutes and barely made it. So they put them back in. How long do you think they lasted? Another 15 minutes? Maybe only 10, maybe only 5. 60 hours. You heard me right, 60 hours. You know why? Because those rats knew and they hoped, because they had been rescued once, they'd be rescued again. When a bunch of rats feel like they're going to be rescued and they can go that long, what does that say to us as the human family? We know Jesus has promised to take us back. We know that he's coming to rescue us and give us that hope. And I am so grateful for the hope that Jesus gives to us. So let's take a closer look, because now we get to the most remarkable part of the entire human history. Actually, we could say the universal history of the world, because Christ was just crucified. His disciples scattered. Why did they scatter? Because hope was lost. Because you see, messiahs don't die. Their messiah was to overthrow the Romans and take over the government. There's no reason to keep the Jesus movement moving if your Messiah died. Let me say that again. There's no reason to keep the Jesus movement moving when your Messiah dies. And so they lost hope. Hope had taken the last train to nowhere. These disciples, not even the disciple John, believed that Jesus was the Messiah. In fact, in Luke 24, 21, it says, we had hoped. That's past tense. We had hoped. He was the Messiah and had come to rescue it. Now they still had hoped that he'd rescue Israel. But messiahs don't die. Now that he died, their hope was lost. It was over. So many had hoped, and now they felt abandoned. They didn't know what to think. And they were hiding in every nook and cranny in Jerusalem because they thought they would be next crucified. They all run. They don't even show up for the funeral. They don't lock arms and say, hey, if you're going to crucify Jesus, you're going to crucify us. See, the epicenter of Jesus' mission was Jesus. And it died when Jesus died, according to them. And that's why I believe the story. And that's why I'm so convinced. Because something happens right after that. You and I know the story. But you see, if we were back then, we probably would have followed in those same footsteps. Those disciples lost hope. They didn't believe he was the Messiah anymore. I want to take you to Matthew 28. after the Sabbath. You see, after the Sabbath, Joseph and Nicodemus, they embalmed Jesus real quickly after the Sabbath. They had asked for his body, and, you know, if a couple of men do it, the women figure it wasn't done right, so they got to go do it the next day. And at dawn, the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled it back on the stone and sat on it. Now, I don't know what angels do, but just to me, like Max Lucado, the angel just decides to roll the stone. Now he's going to sit on it. He's just going to sit on the stone, cross his legs, whistle a happy tune. Like, he's just there. Now, of course, the Roman soldiers fall like dead men, but he's waiting. This angel, I believe he's Gabriel, is waiting for these women to show up to tell them the good news of Christ's resurrection. As his appearance was like lightning, his clothes were white as snow, the guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. Last week we talked about how these men were guarding a dead man, and now they become like dead men, and the dead man who they thought was dead is alive. So they run to town and they tell everyone the good news. The angel said to the women, "Don't be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was what? Crucified. He is not here. He is risen. Just as he said, come and see the place where he lay." Now, those three words in the English language, "he is risen," is one word in the Greek. Agerthe. Say it with me. Agerthe. Agerthe. He is risen. He is risen. Listen to the next verse. "Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead." He has risen from the dead. Now, John gives an insight. He tells us that there was a handkerchief or a napkin that had been around his head, not lined with the linen cloth, but folded together in a place by itself. Now, what does that mean? There's something very significant here, and you have to go back into the Jewish history or culture. You see, when a family was eating, the master of the table, he would sit over here, and everyone would stay there until the master was finished, and the servants would stand by, and if the master was done, he would just wad up his napkin, his handkerchief, and he just wad it up and put it there, and he'd leave. But if he folded his napkin and left, it meant he's coming back. He's coming back. Jesus did something very significant for the whole Jewish culture, for us to understand that he is coming back. He gives us this hope. He's coming to rescue us. I'm coming back. It was folded together. Isn't that good news? Jesus is coming back for you and for me. So here we are 2,000 years later in the 21st century, and on every continent, in almost every country, there are people like you and I celebrating this one event because of this one single solitary life gives us this hope that you and I know there's not just this life. There's something so much more. So I close with the story. I'm in Waterloo, Iowa. Waterloo, it's the icebox of the nation. I remember I went out for a run one day, and I knew it was cold, but it was actually 40-some below zero. I felt like someone took a sledgehammer. I was wearing mittens, smashed my fingers. And anyway, I'm there, and a young man by the name of Terry, he comes back from New York to be with his family because he's dying. And his parents want to make certain that his life is comfortable. He's a wonderful family, and I'm going to just share this part, that he had lived a kind of life that most people wouldn't approve of, and he got AIDS. But I remember he came to church with his mom and dad, and he was probably in his 20s. And I said, "Hey, would you like to have Bible studies?" He said, "Yes." So I went to his apartment. Actually, he was staying in the whole upstairs, and he was an interior decorator. I just have to say this. I had never seen someone decorate an apartment. He had the whole upstairs apartment. It was fabulous. I just want to say, interior decorator, just amazing. We began Bible studies. And I'll tell you what, after the Bible studies, his transformed life was everyone has a story. His story was amazing. He told me his life. I won't share it with you. But he gave his heart to Jesus that was so solid, and he wanted to get baptized. He wanted to get baptized. So I said, let's do it. And so he set a date, and quite a few of the members said, hey, you pastor, you better not get in that water with him. He had AIDS and all this. I'm doing it. I'm doing it. So I had all these people rebuking me, and I said, you know what? He wants to give his life to Jesus. Baptize the guy. He got real sick, and then he died. We planned for the funeral. Now, what I didn't tell you, and I talked to his folks, I had already put in, I had a flight and everything. I was going to run the Honolulu Marathon. And so I told the family, you know, I won't go. No. I said, you need to go. You've been planning on this for some time. And so so I made certain that I'd come back the day before the funeral. So I went, and there I was. I went, and I ran the marathon. I ran the first half of the marathon with Carla Berkskins. She was the fastest woman in the world. She had won 8 times in a row the Honolulu Marathon. I couldn't keep up with her. I only ran 13 miles with her. She outdid me. I'm not that good. She's really good. And so anyways, I come back the day before. I'm going to fly out. I'm flying out. I'm going to get there the day before. So I get to the Honolulu airport, and it is mayhem. Let me tell you, I had never seen an airport in such chaos. People are fighting each other. They're up at the ticket counters, super angry. The Rodney King beating, or the verdict had come out, and so flights were canceled. This is back in 1989, I think it was. Anyways, I've tried to get my ticket. I had my ticket. It was no good. It's no good. I said, well, I got to get back. I went to the lady. And I don't remember if it was American Airlines. I told her my story. I said, listen, I have this guy. I'm a pastor. I've got to get back, and I've got a funeral. He says, well, we don't have any tickets, but I'll give you a standby. She says, don't tell anyone, okay? I said, no, I sure won't. She says, I only gave one to another person, and we'll see if someone can't get on. So me, I go, and I sit down. I'm sitting by the other guy. He's a doctor. And so he's a doctor from Los Angeles. So we're sitting there, and we have the last two numbers. So they start calling in everyone, and then they start calling the standby. And guess what? They call both our numbers. So I get on the plane, and then I'm looking. I'm going to the way back, and guess what? There is no seat. I don't see a seat. And so one of the flight attendants said, sir, because I'm the last one on there, says, sir, we're sorry. We made a mistake. I said, well, you couldn't have. I said, I've got a ticket. I'm on this plane. I said, I'll sit in the jump seat. No, you can't. I said, I'll sit over here. I'll stay up with the guys in the cab. No, you can't do that. You know, I was trying to figure out how I could stay. I said, I'll tell you what. I said, I'll just stay in the bathroom the whole time. She says, you can't. I said, I'll go up in the luggage. I'm sure I can fit up. No, you can't do that. I was trying everything. She says, no, you cannot do that. And I said, oh, man. So I get off the plane, and I literally, now listen, I'm going to just be very, is it okay if I be real blunt with you? You're going to think, I don't know if I want this guy to be my pastor anymore. I went to the bathroom, I closed the stall door, I just pounded my fist, and I said, Lord, you got me on there. I prayed for some way to get on that flight. Now there's no other flights. I said, what am I going to do? And I figured I had to take things in my own hand because God wasn't doing anything. So I went over, and I kid you not, I stood by the ticket counter, and I just kind of watched. And I had conjured in my little mind a little plan. You know that passenger boarding bridge? It's kind of like a tunnel, and then it leads you all the way up to the door of the plane. I was going to wait until they took that off, and I was just going to run into the plane. And I did. I did. I remember watching. It's kind of like a conveyor belt, and it's starting to go back. And I thought, you know what? I'm not Carl Lewis, but I'm going to run as hard as I can. And I don't know if it was 20 feet, 30 feet, but I remember watching as they were taking that off. No one was around, and I ran as hard as I could, and I leaped. And I tell you what, I looked down, and it's a long ways down there. If I fell, I was another funeral. So anyways, I landed, and I kind of fell. And someone heard me, and I just ran back to the very back. There were still people trying to get in their seat. I ran to the very back, and I remember I thought, I'm going to the bathroom, but they're not going to find me. And I got these knock on the door, and there was two pretty good-sized TSA guys. They looked at me, one's going like this, and the other's going like this. I said, hey, why don't I just sit back here? And I went and I folded down those jump seats. Nope, not going to do it. They got on either side of me, and they literally carried me out of that. Stopped the whole thing, had to bring the conveyor belt back, took me off the plane, and then I thought, oh, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? And, you know, it's a good thing it wasn't before, this was before 9/11. I would have been arrested, I'm sure. And so, anyways, I get back out, and the couple that dropped me off, because I was staying with them, really nice. They were former church members, and they now lived in Hawaii. They saw me jump. They said, we saw you jump. We knew they'd take you off. And said, well, what are we going to do? They said, well, let's start in the middle. Now, in Honolulu, the airport is like a half mile. I mean, from one end, they said, well, let's just go right here in the center. See, let's just pray. They said a little prayer, and they said, you know, we'll go this direction. We'll go this way. You go this way. So everyone, no. I finally get to the very last one. I just said, Lord, please, may there be a flight. And the lady looks at me and says, someone just canceled. Someone just said that they couldn't be here. She says, I have a ticket for you, but you have to go get me your other flight ticket in order to give you this one. Now, you got to remember, they went this way. I went this way. It's a half mile away. And she says, I said, can you hold it for me? She says, I can't hold it. But she says, if you hurry, it'll be here. So I ran. I mean, I just did a marathon the day before. And so I ran as hard as I could. I'm jumping over luggage and over children and over everything, you know, all of these things. And so, and there's these flight workers. They're saying, look at that guy go. Because I could have challenged Usain Bolt. Man, I was flying. And then finally I see them, Raymond and Teresa. And I said, Raymond, Teresa, I need my ticket because I think I've got one of hers. So I ran back. And they said, there he goes again. So I ran back and I said, I've got my ticket. And she says, you know what I did? Someone else came and asked for it. And she hung her head down. She says, but I saved it for you. I said, thanks a lot. So anyway, she gave it to me, and then I had to pay for this one. And I thought, you know, I didn't want to buy, you know, five other passengers on this plane, but it was really expensive. I thought, okay, but I got to get back. So I'm thinking, as I'm waiting for my flight, I had to go through Chicago and then to Kansas City, and so it was a little detour, but as I'm getting on the plane, I heard this voice. He was the next-door neighbor to me, Perry Kachuk, who we live next door in Japan together, and he says, every time you get to the airport, there's going to be a great lesson the Lord wants for you. I thought, oh, man, and I'm hearing this voice from Perry Kachuk just in my mind, like Perry Kachuk's reminding me this, and as I'm getting on the plane, guess who is right behind me? Perry Kachuk. I kid you not, Perry Kachuk is on that flight. If I had gotten on the original flight, I would have not been with Perry Kachuk. And so we sat together, and guess what? I knew why I was sitting with him. He was going through a very difficult time in his life. He's going through a divorce. And after we were done, he says, you know, he says, I'm certain God put us together, gave me hope again. Hope again. I get back home. I have the funeral for the family. When I have the funeral for the family, the parents of Terry come up to me afterwards and they say, you know, Pastor, we know that it took a lot for you to get back here, but one of the greatest things that we want to say is that our son, we have this hope that our son, we will meet him again. And we know that the hope that we have in Jesus Christ is unlike any other hope in the world. And they shared this verse with me. I'm only going to share this. Is, you know, this is a verse we've been camping on for the last few weeks. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything you can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and your minds as you live in Christ Jesus. When you know for a fact that Christ rose from the grave for you, you will have peace knowing that he has something better than just this life. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for your word, how it speaks life to us today. And I pray that each and every one of us will hang on to the hope that you're returning soon. You folded the napkin. You've promised that you're going to take us home again. And we thank you for that. May we rely on your word and not our feelings. And may we trust you in all things. We thank you in Jesus' precious name and for his sake. Amen. I want to thank you for coming today, and I hope you have a great week. May God bless you all real good.